Now, say my name.
The Rolling Bad Podcast.
You're goddamn right.
Coming to you almost live from a med rehab facility in Rio Rancho, New Mexico, it's the Rolling Bad Podcast, episode number 132. It is July 31st, and I'm your host, Bill. Screw COVID, cure the flu, please. Castello, and with me today?
Remotely, all the way from the unshipped product warehouse of GW, it's Joshua. Oh man, I'm about to ship these hands. Alt.
You're not foreshadowing the After Dark, are you, at all?
We talked about this several times, but we've got our updates on it, you know.
The rant is back.
Well, this whole show might be kind of a rant, because we're going to be going in deep on sort of the state of the hobby,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Looking at AOS, 40K, all the things, and just sort of given where we think it is. And so, well, I think the disclaimer here, Bill, right, is that we're not here to beat up on GW.
Right.
We've got a lot of constructive criticism about things, you know, take it or leave it, agree with us or not. We just got some emotions about things. And so this is going to be our therapy podcast,
yeah,
where Bill and I are able to air grievances and hopefully point in the direction of some possible resolutions.
And that's the whole idea is, yeah, we're going to bring up some ideas and opinions about what we think are wrong, but we're also going to try to give reasonable solutions to the players, not to GW. I mean, I'm not going to try to tell a game designer how to design a game.
Yeah.
I don't tell doctors how to doctor. I think the same thing applies. But we're going to try to give you an idea of, you know, hey, these are some of the things they've said, and this is what you can do. So, yeah, stay tuned for that. So, as we alluded to at the top, I have been sicker than a dog. This flu, and of course, you know, living in COVID times where, you know, you try to kind of isolate as much as possible, Pam and I have just been throwing this flu back and forth to each other, which makes it worse.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's, you just literally pass it back and forth. I mean, I tested 3 times in the last 2 weeks for COVID because I was reasonably sure this could not be just a flu, and came back negative every time. So it's just a flu, but
Jesus,
I'm good now. I mean, I missed the MCP on Tuesday just because I literally could not get out of bed. I finished up doing some work that day, and I just was, like, out of it. But, oh, well, happens to everybody. Little bit pumped because I bought my plane tickets for Nova last night. So now it's set in stone. I
awesome.
Am going.
Awesome. That's great. That's great. I'm looking at my trial schedule for that time of year, and I just don't think I can get out.
Yeah, it's a... Especially over the Labor Day weekend. I mean, I can imagine there's going to be so much dumped on your office. So.
It's crazy. I think we have 4 or 5 homicide trials between September and January.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, it's getting real. And I'm probably going to be brought in a second chair on a few of them. So.
Oh, boy.
Yes, sir. It's going to be a wild time. A wild time.
Yep. Also, in the intro, we do kind of want to deal with a reasonably sad episode for our local community, mm-hmm, where we lost one of our members. You want to take it away?
Yeah, sure. So there's a local player. He was actually big in the local cosplay scene as well.
Yep, yep.
Mainly a 40K player named Spencer Cerame. He was taken very suddenly a couple weeks back. It was kind of a shock to the system where so many people were like, but is this real? Like, I'm still getting people asking, like, did this really happen? You know,
that was my reaction. What the? He's way too young.
He is very young, right? I think he's early 30s.
Yeah.
He survived by his girlfriend and their 2 children.
Yep.
Very unfortunate. And it just sort of underscores, you know, like how we got to be thankful for the time that we have with the people that are around us and in a sort of like tight knit community like we have here and like any type of wargaming community.
Yeah.
Right. It's incumbent upon us to appreciate the time that we do have with each other. So many times we get caught up in little things and bicker about stuff, but you know, perhaps we can, in a way, look to be kinder to others than ourselves because we never know when someone might be taken suddenly. And so What I'll be doing is I'll give it to Bill for the show notes. There's currently a GoFundMe if anyone's interested in helping out. The family will be available. I spread it through the local community as well. But you know, it's sad when we lose one of our own.
It really is. And you know, suddenly like that. And I think part of it is, and we're going to cover this a little bit more in the After Dark, but when we first met this guy, he was not exactly the kind of person we would hang out with on a regular basis. You know, he kind of was the typical gamer with the lack of personal attention to appearance, and perhaps personal hygiene might have been a little bit lacking. So there was a little bit of standoffishness from most people, but quite literally once he got his girlfriend and the kids came into the picture, he literally just did a 180.
Yep.
And he was just a regular guy that you could argue about, you know, which Primarch is better, what Legion is better. And, you know, it was one of those deals where maybe you need to look a little bit beyond, because he was the same dude, just cleaned up a little bit. Maybe look a little beyond the appearance. And, you know, like you said, appreciate what we have when we have it.
Yeah, I'll definitely be going a little deeper into that and certain concepts, and I'll share my own personal experience of this loss.
Yeah.
As perhaps, you know, maybe some wisdom for others to look forward to. When you run into these situations, we appreciate, you know, everyone hearing us out and all that, but, you know, appreciate the people around you.
Yep.
You know, you never know when they're gone.
That's right. All right, so let's move it on to bigger, better, more pleasant things with the New Dawn. And New Dawn's kind of like short.
It is. Might be one of our shortest ones.
I know.
In a long time. I've been on the show like a year and a half now.
Yeah.
And we've usually eaten up a ton of time with New Dawn. Of course, pending news at 11.
True.
But it seems, I don't know if it's sort of a quick breath, like deep breath. You know, we covered some of the stuff, you know, last time in terms of the contrast paints coming up, right? And boy, did those contrast paints come out.
Oh, wow. And the shades. I cannot forget the shades. Wow.
Yeah, they're absolutely amazing. I love the new recipe, so to speak.
Yeah.
Formula, I guess we'll call it, for even the older shades. Actually really like how they go on.
Yeah.
Like Nuln Oil has never worked so well for me.
Yep.
You know, I just... Oh, God, because I've been painting a lot of stuff. You know, I'll tell you about that in creation.
And on a side note, okay, so for Star Wars Legion, Stormtroopers, which have always been the bugaboo, have just become a three-step process.
Yep.
Literally paint them white, hit them with the new white shade, and then the black parts that are supposed to be black get painted black. And that's in. You are done. You can churn out units of Stormtroopers in 30 minutes if you have a good method for putting on the black where it has to go.
Oh, and the white scar spray can't be understated and all that.
God!
It is my favorite spray. You know, so my first favorite was Chaos Black, right?
Yes.
And you know why I do like my golds and silvers and stuff? Those are really handy for certain, you know, things you're trying to do. Love Mechanica Standard Gray.
Yes.
Right? The reason being is that the coverage is so good,
smooth,
but it doesn't clog up detail.
Yes.
Right? And this new white scar spray, dear God.
I'm at the verge right now of I'm ready to throw away all my cans of Corax White.
Yeah.
The only reason I'm keeping them is going to be for terrain. You know,
that's fair.
That's the only thing that I will keep them for, because for anything that I'm going to put more than an hour into, it's the new white scar. It is. I don't want to say why did it take you so long, because there was a certain advancement with pigment development that made smooth whites. So you will be seeing other companies coming out with better white primers.
Yep.
GW just, you know, they have the ability to put money at this and we're able to bring it out first. But I'm like, okay, so this was an industry-wide thing, not just a GW research. You know, there's no little bunker where GW scientists are hard at work.
Yeah.
But it's so good. Oh, my God.
Yeah, and I'll just do a brief comment on it. You know, this is more creation-style stuff, but I've sprayed a Deimos Rhino and a Sigvald that I'm going to use as a Demon Prince in 40K with
disgusting.
It.
Disgusting.
I know, right? assless chaps all day. So, like, the thing with, you know, like, any type of box-like vehicle You got to get in the nooks and crannies. Yeah. So you have to angle it just right. Mm-hmm. But like the way it hits all that gorgeous detail on Sigvald, like, blows my mind. And it's there. Like, it's not clogged.
Yeah.
It doesn't look powdery like the Korax. Like, it is just clean. And it, like, glows. Like, yeah. It's to the point where, like, I don't even know how much paint I want to put on this thing.
Yeah.
Because it's just so pretty.
I'm kind of scared sometimes using that new white because I'm like, well, I can't be done priming. I can't.
Yeah.
Because you're so used to Korax white where you would put on a layer and you would bring one of those big poofy brushes with you to get rid of the chalky parts and then hit it again. And now I'm like, wait a minute. I did this in one coat. What?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Enough foaming about Korax or White Scars. It's a great spray paint. Yes. It's a premium price. But well worth it.
Yeah, I definitely think so.
Yeah, anything that you want to have with a white base coat, you know, or with a white primer, that's where you go right now.
Oh, yeah, and I can't wait for it for all the white scars I'm about to do.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the other, I mean, the actual contrast paints are fantastic. A lot of single pigment paints. So, like, you want that yellow. Oh boy. The Bad Moon's yellow is just screaming at you. It's so bright.
It was either Pete the Wargamer or it might have been Naomi over at Sword and Steel, the YouTube channel, talking about the yellow. It literally blew me away what they were able to do with one coat. I also, you know, I want to throw mad props out to Black Legion, which is literally black paint. It's not very contrasty, but it's also so thin and it covers so well that it's so much easier to achieve good blacks. And I thought I was in love with Black Templar, and I am still. But if you need solid black, that Black Legion is just, it's heroic.
Yeah, it's Abaddon Black in a contrast form. It is so good. I used it on all of my bolt guns and stuff.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And the ribbing on some things. I'll talk more about that in creation. But it's so good. It's so good.
It just pops.
Like, I mean, this, I can't talk. I mean, we can go through each individual paint, but that's what
we're not
for.
Going to. Yeah. They're very good. Buy the contrast paints. Don't hate yourself later. Buy them now.
Hey, speaking of Black Legion, Chaos Space Marines had a big launch yesterday.
Oh, did they?
We all know where Bill's loyalties lie, but you got your Dark Commune, you got your Chosen, I want to call them Havocs. The Chosen came out. You got your Cultists, the Warp Smith, and then I can't remember what they called it, like the Desecrator or something like that, but it's the Venom Crawler with the Obliterators. A bunch of the little things off to the side that you've been wanting, of course, no Possessed yet. That's what literally everyone's waiting for.
Yeah.
Like, I need Possessed all day, every day, please. Because those things are going to be shredding the table. And I think they're already starting, but those guys are absurd. Yeah. Like, I need World Eaters Possessed running through everything right now.
And they will.
Yeah.
They certainly will. Yeah, it's crazy. I would imagine they'll be out here shortly. The outcry for them is huge. So they are definitely coming.
It is. So, yeah, like a lot of good stuff for Gas, but it's more sort of like the ancillary release, right? Yeah. Just the... All right, guys, the stuff we didn't do the first time, here it is. Am I taking Chosen? I don't know yet. But I'm definitely taking Possessed when those come out. As some of the old Possessed, and like the models are still funny to me.
Yeah.
You know, because you can model them like after all the different Chaos Gods and stuff, which I was doing for Bile. I had them like, you know, with the sampling of the different ones for experimentation purposes, right? But the new ones are just so pretty. We also need the Mutants and the Torments to come out as well. So hopefully soon on those, but that was kind of it. The Leviathan Dreadnought for Horus Heresy came out as well. I pre-ordered two of them. Haven't seen hide nor hair of those. We'll talk about that later. So I picked up one over at Twin Suns here in Albuquerque. Here in Albuquerque. Yeah, because I was just like, oh, God, I have to grab one. And then they had Assault Marines.
Yes.
And I needed five more to make the jump pack squad for Horus Heresy for my White Scars. So I was like, yeah, I'll get one of those, too.
Yeah, grab one of those. Yeah, I went down and picked up Leviathan at Eton, and I don't know why, but I picked up another squad of Mark Sixes, more Beakies. That was so dumb. But, you know, you can never have enough Beakies.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and then the pre-order for yesterday was a single item, which was the new Warcry box set. And boy, is there a lot of love slash hate on the interwebs for that box.
Oh, yeah.
It's pricey, and I get it, but it's also a big box of terrain and two, you know, it's a starter box. Incredibly pricey for a starter box. But, you know, it's typical GW. You're getting the rule book. You're getting everything you need to jump in. Or you got to know that probably within a week or two, they're going to release just the rule book.
Yeah.
So if that's all you need, go that route. But they've been covering the changes on the community site. They've been talking about how the cards are changing, how, you know, reactions are being brought into that game as well,
yep.
Which is, you know, we're going to cover when we get to lore what that's all about. But, yeah, I mean, I think it's a good change for Warcry. I kind of embrace it.
Well, we talk all the time about breathing new life into Warcry, yeah. Making sure there's still support for it. And they're bringing the product in line with the rest of the range. It still have its own unique personality, right? But it's bringing it into what all the other games are starting to do, which is great because you want, like, differentiation between your games, right? But not so great that it's literally a whole new setup.
Yeah.
Like going to Necromunda from 40K is not a huge step. Right? Like, same general kind of concepts and everything. Particularly if you're doing, like, God, it's not Path to Glory. What is it? The narrative portion.
Oh, Necromunda.
The narrative portion of 40K.
Crusade.
Yeah, when you're doing Crusade, then you have the ability to, like, change characters and update characters and stuff. So you get kind of an idea of what Necromunda entails, you know? Warcry has a similar aftermath sequence, right? Yeah. Kill Team can have a similar aftermath sequence. So there's a lot of things where you can really easily kind of, like, shift into things. But I think this Warcry box, one thing that I absolutely loved about it is that if you wanted, like, Nurgle themed cultists.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you a happy little camper? Oh,
exactly. Exactly. You know, instead of just, oh, well, I have poxwalkers or sickly looking regular cultists, get these guys and kitbash them. And they look great for that.
They'll definitely pull their weight.
And the terrain is also fantastic in 40K. For, you know, like a poison world, right? Yeah. Like a death world that's poisoned. And I think that's a great aspect to it.
Yeah.
You know? Then, oh, if you think back to, like, Mad Max Fury Road, you know, when they had, like, the poison swamp area that used to be where the green place was, and you have everyone walk around on those stilts.
Yeah.
Just think of the cool things you can do with that, right?
God, just over the top.
Right? There's so many fun things you can do with it. I think it's a great product overall. If you open your mind about what the possibilities are from it, not just the Warcry part.
Not just it's a box and it's super expensive.
Yeah.
Yep. It's a box of opportunity. So, but quite literally, that's New Dawn.
Yeah.
You know, until we get the news at 11, that's it. We can move on to Creation.
Oh, that's going to be a good one.
I think so, because I want to revisit something I talked about in the last show, and that's the wet palette journey that I've been on for, you know, the last 5 years or so.
But yeah.
The Redgrass Games palette came in, and I had watched some of the videos from, you know, some of the people that got it, or the early release of the palette was literally just the paper went out to different people. And I thought it was really neat that you could wash the paper and be done with it. Of course, get the whole thing, get it set up, start using that paper, and had this eureka moment, like, holy crap, this is actually an advancement in wet palettes. And I know last time I said, look, wet palettes are as simple as a plate, a Scott towel, or some sort of absorbent thing and some wax paper, and you're done. Whereas this paper is, it's hard to describe because it's single-sided. There is a side that goes down onto the mat, and then there's a side that is up where you put the paint. And the side that is up is actually shiny. It reminds me almost of the GW palette paper.
Mm-hmm.
It's very slick, and you're like, well, it's almost plasticky. How can the water get through there? But it does. And to fix the issue with the old Redgrass palette where paint generally got too wet, this is just perfect. It keeps it living and alive, but it doesn't add water to it. So if you start making different blended colors and you use whatever, say medium or a gloss medium or a glaze medium, and you put it on that palette, it stays. It does not water down. And I'm just like, oh, this is flipping amazing. The biggest thing is you have to keep water from getting on the top of the palette, because it is sort of, I don't want to say hydrophobic because it's not, but if you get water, a little pool of water on the top of the paper, it will just ruin your paint. It will just thin it down, you know, it'll just water it out. But it's amazing. It's the first real honest to God advancement I've seen in wet palette technology, if you want to call it that. I don't know what you would. It's well worth. And even if you don't want to go the whole route of getting a Redgrass Games palette box, just buy the papers. You know, they sell the paper replacement sheets. They are just amazing.
That's great. Yep. That's great.
I'm super impressed. Now, like I said, I've been sicker than a dog for 2 weeks, so my building has been limited to the Heimdall and Scourge model for MCP. I built another unit of stormtroopers because I wanted to try the white scars.
Yeah.
And, oh my God, so awesome. I'm still pressing on with building the 30K stuff. I'm not going to make the deadline of today, but that's not an issue anymore.
Well, the deadline's pushed to Friday.
Yeah, so that I won't make that either. but, you know, yeah, I'm moving on that. The new set of four Imperium things came out.
Okay.
And I was surprised to see there was Mechanicum in there this time. So you get a whole sprue worth of Mechanicum stuff. And a new binder. The filing system is still different from anything. But, I mean, it's once you figure out how they file the different sheets, it becomes very easy. But it's convoluted and it makes no sense.
Gotcha.
Why don't you just put numbers on there? Okay, anyway. And last but not least, I want to talk about the Citadel Color app.
Mm-hmm.
Guys, take it off. Fix it. Put it back up. It is junk right now.
Yeah.
It is just, I mean, the only thing that it's actually useful for right now is playing some of their videos and keeping an inventory of your paints. Their project section is like missing 98% of the GW models. So you're like, I'm going to start a project with my Raven. Oh, yeah. No, they don't even have 30K in there.
Nope.
I'm going to start doing Night Hunt. Oh, yeah. They don't have any of the new models in there. I'm like, okay. Forget that. So, you know, fix. If you're going to offer something like that, make it worthwhile. If you're going to make it just a place to figure out what paints you need to go buy, strip it down to the inventory and wish list and be done with it.
Yeah.
So, okay, I'm done.
slash end rant. yeah, so on my stuff, I've been diligently working on the Age of Darkness box. I have everything painted up. I'm literally just putting transfers on now.
Nice.
I've got every shoulder pad, you know, gloss varnished, just waiting to go. I put transfers on the Spartan, on the two heroes, and on five of the heavy bolter Marines. So I've got, I think, I did five there. I've got 30 models left to do because five of them have the rocket launchers, which obfuscates the shoulder pad.
Oh, yes.
Right. So I was like, I didn't even think about transfers when I was putting them together. You know, otherwise I might have tried to subassemble. But, I mean, ultimately, I just have, you know, 30 more Marines to put the transfers on and I'm done, which is great.
Nice.
You know, I've already gone over them with varnish and everything too, you know, before like varnish the whole thing before I go back and do the gloss varnish.
Yep.
But they're looking pretty slick right now. So I'm set to have fully painted and transferred, models for the competition,
nice.
Or challenge. I don't know, whatever it's called now.
I don't know. Yeah.
So that's a lot of work.
Yeah.
It's a lot of work. Painting in batches, you know, getting my techniques down. You know, I did have a little bit of a break there where I literally painted up a storm sword for my white scars.
Yep.
So that's pretty much done.
Nice.
As well. I need to get some null oil on the tracks and then figure out what the basing is going to be for my white scars. I'm thinking sort of kind of harkening back to Chigoris with, you know, more grassy, rocky plain stuff. So I'll be working on that because that'll determine what I actually put on the treads.
Yeah.
And I'll probably actually use the Storm Sword for the, it's like Wizards and War Machines Ever Chosen that we're doing as well. That's due at the end of August.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that one. Yeah.
So I'm going to try and get, my buddy Keneal found a guy who's got some Eben Keshig for Hella Sale. So I'm getting 10 of them for $120. When normally it's five for $114 with GW. So nice. Yeah, I'm stoked.
Yeah.
To get those. And what I'm thinking about doing is like doing actually like a display piece for the Storm Sword and have it just like going on the planes and all that. I think it'll be fun. I think it'll be pretty fun. So yeah, that was part of it. Like I said earlier, I did do the White Scars Deimos Pattern Rhino. That is just built and primed for right now.
Okay.
One of the things that kind of sidetracked me, and it's been sidetracking me because we also have the 40K event at the store going on, because we're doing, I think, are we going to start doing the match play stuff? Or the, what's it called?
Crusade?
No, no, there's a Crusade part, but they're also, the store is actually getting one of the boxes for the play where, like, all the other stores get to do it, too.
Oh, yeah. The worldwide event thing that...
Well, regardless, sorry, we're both having senior moments. It's going to be fun, but he's requiring us to have painted models.
Yeah.
Of course, world leaders don't have their codex yet, but I've been building them up, like I said before, with the Berserkers, with the Red Butchers. And one of the things I did is I made a world leaders Hellbrute that I thought was going to be pretty fun. And I will devote one of my Leviathan Dreadnoughts to world leaders as well. But the Hellbrute, because I had done this trade for the other Spartan Rhino that I had because...
Yeah.
That model.
you don't like that
I just
model.
Don't like it. You know, I've loved so many different models, but for some reason that one is just the one.
You know, yeah.
You know, I'm allowed to not like it, right?
You betcha.
He put some money towards a Bloodthirster for me, so I was able to get a Bloodthirster, right? Why are you saying this, Josh? Well, I'm going to build the Bloodthirster of Insensate Rage, right? Yeah. Double-handed axe, can't go wrong in 40K or AOS, right? Yeah. It's a pretty... darn good model. So that left the one-handed axe and the whip.
Uh-oh.
Right? And you know, you can do the like hammer or fist plus the power scourge for the Hellbrute. And it's like, all right, so what do I do for the Hellbrute though? How do I change this up? So I got a Space Wolf Dreadnought. And I built it with Murderfang's face because it kind of looks a little bit like, you know, you might see Angron looking.
Yeah.
Because if you paint the fur, like the cables, like the butcher's nails going into his head, then it definitely looks a little more cornate. And then I took the, sorry guys, I'm having a moment. So I took a knife to all of the runes and the markings and I scored them and slashed them and like, you know, gouged them and stuff like that. So it like broke the runes of protection.
Sure. Yeah.
And so I have it leaning forward where it's got the cornate axe in one hand and it's got the whip.
Oh, nice. From
it in the other hand. Which I know how, like, 40K, like, the modeling stuff, which is, you know, we'll talk a little bit more about, you know, having communication with your opponent as to what you can actually shoot. But, like, the way the whip is, it's, like, positioned, like, perfectly above his head, right? With the, like, the symbol pointing up. Like, I just hit it just right. So it looks like it's actually, like, hands growing out of the dreadnought.
Oh, that's sick.
And then I took the flesh-looking face mask for the knights, and I have it on one of the pauldrons. So, you know, I just chaosed it up a bunch.
A little.
Yeah.
A little.
And so I thought that was really fun to put together. I got that on an actual, I think it's a 60 mil from the Sector Imperialis.
No, okay.
Sector Mechanicum. Yeah. So it's looking good. It's fitting, you know, everything there. I just have to figure out how I'm going to do the Leviathan Dreadnought base for it to kind of fit with the aesthetic.
Sure.
Given that it's on an 80 mil and I don't think there are 80 mils for... like Necromunda style bases.
I don't think so.
Not so
80 mil.
Well, I might have to get one custom printed or something, but you know, figured out. I'm excited for a Leviathan Dreadnought. I've wanted one forever.
Yeah.
And now they're not cost prohibitive, you know, and having to get them shipped and buying the arms separate and blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
But so that's good.
World mentality.
Right. I did open up the Leviathan Dreadnought and I looked at it yesterday and I was like, not today.
Yeah. Not today.
Not today. So I might work on that this afternoon if I've got time.
Cool.
So I think that does it for creation for me.
Can I have a quick go back?
Yeah.
Kabanda came in.
Oh, you got Kabanda.
Yes. And for those of you that don't know, he's the big new demon for Horus Heresy. But, you know, he's also generic demon enough. You can use him for anything. But he's a Forge World model. And I expected it to be the size of most of the other, you know, demon print. Yeah, no, he's in the big Forge World box.
Oh my god.
Not the huge, you know, Thunderhawk
slash
Manta boxes, but he's in the next size down big box for Forge World. I have not opened it up yet. I don't want to get that that feeling of, oh God.
But well, you want to hear about a crazy deal? So my buddy Keneal caught this guy who was like not a going out of business sale, but he was a local game shop somewhere who's advertising stuff online. He got a Thunderhawk for $350.
Oh my God. That's awesome.
Yeah, I was like, you did what? You did what? Oh, God.
That is so good. Oh, man, that is great.
I mean, it's already got, like, Crusade markings and painting on it already. So, like, it's been done, so you might have to actually, like, just kind of fix a few things. But it's, like, even if you don't want to do anything, you have a pre-painted Thunderhawk for $350. Oh, no.
Yeah, geez, my life is terrible. Oh.
Yeah, that was insane. Sorry.
All right, let's take a quick break. We're going to get some breakfast, and then we'll come back to some battle.
Sounds good.
Make sure you join us tonight for the news at 11.
Well, like the lady said, it's actually 11:55 where we were recording the lore, but yeah, we'll make believe. Here's the news at 11.
All right, so we got pre-orders for next week. As Bill and I were talking about, didn't realize initially that the Warcry set is a 2-week pre-order.
That's right. Doesn't ship till next week or, you know, soon.
It's kind of cool because you're like, man, I want that, but I don't have the money until next week. Well, guess what?
You're
actually
in.
You're good to go.
Yep.
So 2-week pre-order on that, hopefully foreshadowing some bigger release that we're going to find out about next Sunday.
Yeah.
Still a great box. So if you've been saving all your pennies for this one, here you go.
It's here.
And then Horus Heresy got a bit of a dump, actually, of things. So starting out, which I really wish I had before, was the digital versions of the Liber Astartes and Hereticus.
Thank you.
Yes.
Oh my God. Anytime that you guys feel the need to put out these books in a machine readable format, please do.
Well, if they're going to keep doing this, and we're talking about some of the cool stuff about Horus Heresy later, but I feel like they might just keep propelling Heresy into a staple.
A stratospheric. Yeah.
From box set to main game.
To main line, yeah. And, I mean, they've already promoted it on the website, so it's its own section. So I think they're behind this 100%, which is great.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
I do love it, so.
Everyone who gets rock hard for the lion, get it? you get your Special Legion heads and shoulder pads this next week, along with... was it Martis Sedrak? Is that his name? Hold on. Bill's trying to catch his breath.
Well, I'm just thinking there's so much double entendre there that I should cut it out, but I can't because it's not obvious. But wow, if you need your head and shoulder. Okay.
Martis Sedrak. That's who it is.
Lord of the 23rd Order.
He was the Horus Heresy Day mini, and now he's available. As much as I don't like Dark Angels, that is a beautiful model.
A gorgeous. Gorgeous model.
That sword, though.
I hate you. GW. Wow. It is so cool. But no, Dark Angel's bad.
Yeah, I'll just convert it to something in 40K. Maybe a Chaos Lord.
Chapter, yeah.
And then this is awesome for me, at least.
Yes.
Emperor's Children and White Scars shoulder pads and torsos.
Those are beautiful. The shoulder pads are just
out of this world.
Very, very nice.
And the torsos, too.
You got Mark IV torsos.
For the Emperor's Children, and it's Mark II for the White Scars.
Yeah.
It's some beautiful stuff. They talked about some of the stuff coming. The heads aren't out yet, but I don't mind getting, some stuff for my basic Marines, because, granted, you have to buy, like, 2 boxes of torsos for every shoulder pad, but...
True.
Whatever. But they look good. They look great.
They look really, they're really up in their game on that. That's Forge World stuff. So
yeah, it looks like it's a made to order, I think, what it's going to be. Probably. So you'll put your orders in and get it at an undisclosed time, just like if you pre-ordered anything else with GW.
Foreshadowing.
And then Warhammer Plus, August 3rd, we're going to get a Warcry Battle Report. I mean, they are hyping this pretty big, so that makes sense.
I'm really going to watch that because I want to really see the changes. I mean, the articles have been great, and I think they've pretty much given up everything. Mm-hmm. And mostly I think these are really good changes.
Yeah, and seeing it in motion, too, will kind of just congeal it, right?
How the reactions are really going to work. So, looking forward to that.
And then Lore Master's taking us to Gurr.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like they're a year, 2 years late on that. But
okay.
Because we've been in Gurr for a little bit.
And in all fairness, Wade has been really sick. And I'm sure the Lore Master's schedule went way back because of he was out for like 4 months.
Ooh.
So, yeah. So, anyway, it's just great to have him back and seeing him do the preview shows and all that stuff and getting into a full schedule again. It's so great to see because Wade is one hell of a guy. So, yeah, that's what's coming up next week. So, kind of a lull. And honestly, with the exception of Warcry, we've been in this area where you can kind of catch your breath a little bit. If you're AOS and 40K, you can kind of go, now if you're 30K, Warcry, well, there goes the wallet. Yeah. it's all good stuff. And yay, I'm looking forward to almost all of it except for the White Scars and Legion. Well, no, I'm not really looking forward to anything except Warcry and the PDFs. Or probably not PDFs, probably.
The EPUBs.
Yeah.
But, I mean, they'll have, like, formatting then so you can easily search through it.
Yeah,
you
can read.
Yeah.
And maybe search. Who knows?
Yeah. Instead of, like, God, how do I get to my Legion?
Yeah.
Which page is it on?
And where did that rule go?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so that should be good.
I do know a little birdie told me that a wonderful, wonderful human being is working on an app for 30K that's going to have all of the special rules, and it's going to be phone-based. So it'll have just you punch in a special rule you want to see, and boom, there's the text. Making it super handy during the game. Plus, it's going to have the weapon profiles. And I've seen kind of what the format's going to look like. And, oh, my God, is it going to be a huge help? Huge help.
Love it.
And, honestly, it should be relatively easy to maintain once it's off the ground. So, but I don't know how all that web development stuff works when you're actually doing subscriptions to data. I don't know. But it'll be fun to see. Okay, on to battle. On a full stomach, life is good.
Yes, sir.
I got in 2 games of AOS that basically played into the section of this show because we played the exact same scenario twice, once using the current General's Handbook, and the game was an absolute crap show.
Yeah.
Then we played it with no battle pack whatsoever, with just the battle pack from the core rule. And oh my God, was that fun. And it was a breath of fresh air to play sort of purist, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And in the first game, I lost reasonably badly with actually no hope of winning, really just because of the situation with the Daughters of Cain being able to sit on objectives and just giggle as you try to take them.
Yeah.
And there was literally no point to trying to take them just to get tabled in the process. Whereas the next game was tooth and nail. It was a dead heat going into round 4 or the bottom of round 3 where we burned I got to burn an objective. And that swung the game. It was literally a 2-point swing. Well, it was a 3-point swing. But and that was that. And it was so close.
Yeah.
Coming down to really round 5 and almost the bottom of my turn, which I had priority. And that was pretty much when it was over. And it was nice to have a game that actually was competitive all the way through. And the armies played the way you expected them to play. You didn't have to shoehorn them into a different... Well, I'm getting into lore. But, yeah, it was 2 fun games. And that was it. Because I was sick, I missed the first week of the MCP League.
Mm-hmm.
So I have my makeup game today at between 2:30 and 3 over there. So... Yeah, and then, of course, Tuesday we'll pick up the league and play again. So,
there you go.
Little MCP going on. So Nick Fury and the Fury Hippo Squad. That's an inside joke, and it's the Hippo Squad has made me a drink or two. So Anyway, on to you. What you got?
Well, I didn't actually play any games. In recent time, I was in a trial. It's a pretty difficult case. So, you know, like when I became a prosecutor, you know, my thoughts are, and particularly how I viewed it from a defense attorney's perspective, is that, you know, the prosecutor doesn't always get it. Like they generally don't get to pick their case, but they can dismiss some. Sometimes there are reasons why they're not allowed to dismiss cases. And sometimes, like has been my case for me since I picked up the caseload, is that I've been, you know, bearing the dogs that others birthed. Is what it is. And this was a dog of a case. And it was one of those things where there was enough for me to prosecute it, right? I was very skeptical of prevailing at a jury trial. But sometimes you just got to do that because the parties can't come to a resolution. Sure. It was something where they're charged with multiple felonies and I literally offered a misdemeanor. And they're like, nope, we're rolling dice. And
oh, I was like, boy.
Okay. I mean, I saw all the defense avenues in this case. You know, I knew them from the time I read it. I was like, oh, yeah. So we got there. I mean, we outperformed the defense attorney every step of the way, right? But unfortunately, you can't outperform the facts of a case.
Yeah,
exactly. We used to have a joke where you may file a motion for new facts. But
I like that one.
Unfortunately, I couldn't do that in this case. But I mean, you know, in something that I thought it was like, I bet they're going to come back in 15 minutes, not guilty. We got them thinking for about an hour, you know, before they came back. And I mean, at the end of the day, ultimately the complaining witness just wasn't believable.
Yeah.
Because frankly, she lied to the cops.
Okay.
And then changed the story afterwards and all those things. And I was like, yeah, I mean, I can try the case. I think there's probable cause, but are we going to prevail? We are likely not to prevail. However, I will take it to trial just to make sure that, you know, the jury system does what the jury system's supposed to
do. That's right, yeah.
So they came back not guilty, and I was like, cool.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Yeah.
This case is over.
Yeah.
I've attempted to try this case 4 times prior to this, but COVID literally kept getting in the way, whether it was witness, me, or the defense attorney. So it was just kept pushing. I'm like, now it's finally off my desk. You know, it was a day and a half. It wasn't complicated, but, you know, we did it.
It doesn't matter. You still have to prep. You still have to do all the work.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And so my thoughts are, you know, as a prosecutor, if, you know, I go in there and I do my job, you know, completely and competently, and the jury decides, no, you don't, we don't think you got it, then that's fine.
Yeah.
Because that's what the system's that's meant to do.
What you're supposed to do.
Right. So that was my battle that I had in the last few weeks. It was definitely a battle.
A little higher stakes than plastic.
Little note too is the first trial I've ever lost.
Oh man.
Yeah. I'm still undefeated as a defense attorney.
Nice.
But I don't believe my job is to be undefeated as a prosecutor. Because if it's a solid case, they're most likely to plea unless they're an idiot.
Yeah.
And sometimes you just need a jury to say, hey, no, it's not there.
Yeah.
You know, I can turn around and look at the people who I said it's not here and go, I told you.
Yeah.
So either way, justice is done, and that's what my job is here for. So I guess technically I won.
Yeah. There you go. The system wins.
Yeah.
All right. All right. So with that, I guess we move on to the meat. Here's the beef.
Yeah, I mean, you've been asking where's the beef all podcast up to this point.
That's right. Well, here's the beef.
Yeah.
Here's what we're going to do. In lore, we're going to talk about the different game systems and our opinions, stressing that this is not an indictment of any system or rule set or group or what have you. This is simply our thoughts on where we are and how potentially you can mitigate. If you agree with us, you can mitigate these things. And if you think we're crazy, drop a note in the Discord and tell us how stupid we are. I know my opinions are off the wall and probably aren't shared by even a minority of the majority.
I mean, y'all still listen to us, right? So we probably say something interesting, right? Or at least entertaining. Right. But I do want to put a little caveat as to the, you know, we're not trying to denigrate anyone. We are not including you, Steve, specifically Steve.
Yeah.
There's no way that you, Steve, are going to be able to overcome your imperfection. No, I'm kidding. I picked Steve at random. I had, you know, Steven, Charles. No.
No, don't use Charles.
I had Steven, Frank, Jason. Like there is a few names in my head.
See?
You know, so sorry, Steve.
Yeah. And I want to go back to this is all based around the idea of the title of the show. is just because we can do a thing doesn't mean we should.
Yep.
So starting out with the state of AOS, mm-hmm. I'm going to open up with a blanket statement that says this latest General's Handbook is bad. It's not good. It leads to games that are not fun. I want to say a majority of the cases. I think this, more than the monster meta that we had before, this General's Handbook limits your list design space and creativity to a degree that I think is detrimental to the book itself and to the amount of effort they put into it. Mm-hmm. I think it enforces a play style that doesn't appeal to everyone. And I just think it's bad. I think it was, yes, we can do this. Yes, we can beef up battle line units in this way. I think maybe other alternatives were not considered well enough.
Yeah, and what I wrote down on our thing is that I felt like it was like an incomplete writing prompt where like you look at it and you're like, okay, I could really go at these themes, but there's other things that could have been developed more. And so like in terms of what stories, so to speak, comes out of it, it's imbalanced towards a particular way, you know, and doesn't feel like a cohesive story. You know, I had a lot of promise for it because like, oh, finally, battle lines are going to do something. But it's this thing, it's this pendulum swing, man.
Yeah.
You know, you're like, God, monsters are just oppressive. Sons of Behemoth are just wrecking everyone's face. And then it swings the other direction. You're like, I can't move a bunch of mostly naked, bloody women off of this table.
Yeah.
Literally bloody, not the British bloody. I can't get them off the table. I mean, they're just there. And then the other ones on the other side of the table are just shredding me apart. You know, it swings too heavy. And I just don't think that it allows for speaking competitively.
Yes.
Right? For good balance.
Yes.
Because I would hope for balance, but it's like, just because the monsters did super good before, right, doesn't mean that the battle lines have to come in and just, like, destroy. Can we find somewhere in between?
Yeah, is there a possible method where you could have achieved a more competitive balance thing? And I don't know, honestly, what I do want to say is the General's Handbook is amazingly well put together, well prepared for what they're doing. It's very well thought out.
Yeah.
Although, it, like I said, it does limit your design space incredibly, where you literally, for competitive events, you have to build to a certain methodology mm-hmm. that might not be what you want to do, but you are forced into it.
Yeah.
And most of the time we look at these things and we're like, oh, well, that's okay. I have 60 witch elves from, you know, before, and that's not a big deal. I can just now use them and they're amazingly good. Yay. Discounting the fact that in a competitive scene, you don't really care, mm-hmm. but how much fun is that game going to be? Now, also need to say and hit this right away, the very beginning of the General's Handbook and in the core rules, they stress, the people that write this stuff stress that you can use whatever parts you like, mm-hmm. whatever parts you don't like, you don't use.
Yep.
And that harkens back to like the battle that I was talking about where we played the same exact scenario with the same list twice. We had a very unfun game. And then we had a game that was bonkers good.
Yeah.
That actually sort of rekindled, because to be quite honest, my motivation for AOS has been flagging. Mm-hmm. But honestly, playing with just the core rules just reinvigorated everything.
Great.
And yeah, cause it was actually fun. Now finding other people that might do that, hey, that might be thin, but whatever. But again, the caveat to all of this is you're not required to use anything in any General's Handbook.
Yep.
And if you still want to play the monster meta, there is zero rule that says you cannot. Now that this new one's out, the mm-hmm. old one is gone.
Yeah.
No, it's still in there. The print is still good. I checked. My copy's okay.
Yeah.
So they didn't have like an eraser mechanic.
Not the BMW heated seats subscription.
Oh, I love how that's just being... Okay, anyway.
you didn't think you were going to get hacked. Are you serious? Yeah. Anyway, that's a side note.
Yes. Honestly, the answer here is if this General's Handbook, or even if the last one, and I'm guilty of this, I can remember saying at the end, toward the end of that handbook, I was getting really tired of the monster meta. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't taking my own advice, just not play with it.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can go back to anything you want. Go to the Thondia Battle Pack. It's fun. It's different. It's weird. Mm-hmm. And it might be something you like better. Or just don't play with any of them. Or just pick out chunks.
Yeah.
Now, when you're picking out chunks, be careful, because not taking it in its totality can lead to some weird... weird rules interactions, but you know, feel free to play the game your way. And if your group doesn't like this book, and honestly, I'm seeing a lot of stuff on the interwebs mm-hmm. where people are not totally in favor of this,
yeah,
just don't use it.
Yep.
The only place that it is required to be used is organized games workshop events.
Yep.
Okay. So 5% of the events in the world, this is a requirement for any of your events. Hey, use what you want. I know I'm going to put out an update to the pack for LVO for the narrative that we are not using any battle packs. You are going to bring the core rule book and the Thondia book so that you can have the Anvil of Apotheosis. And that's it. Mm-hmm. That's all you're going to need. None of these battle packs are going to apply. None of these regiments, none of these veteran rules, none of that is going to cloudy up the system. So feel free to break from and only play the game that you want to play with your group.
Yeah, it's another kind of part of the discussion, too, is like how you compare. Are you playing competitively? Are you playing just match play for the rule structure? Are you playing narratively? Is it open play? Because those are all those different forms of play. And I think oftentimes we'll get caught up in thinking only competitively, right? Yes. What's super strong? What's not? You know, I even think, too, the local store has, like, literally a Path to Glory campaign going on, including Anvil of Apotheosis, and I'll be damned if we don't see Marathi on the board.
Oh, yeah.
Kragnos. All those things, because someone upped the ante on it, right? How do you control that? No unique characters.
Right.
Right? Well, then that changes it, right?
Yeah.
Those are all the things that you can do. Of course, there is some frustration, because in terms of competitive play, you need consistency.
Yes.
Right? Because you don't want to be like doing really well just because of how the battle pack structured. Then you go to this other tournament, it's structured differently, and then you just get raffle stomped, you know?
Exactly.
It's frustrating from that standpoint if what you're doing is trying to play competitively, you know?
Yeah.
But that's not the only way to play, and that's not the only mindset. And frankly, it could be beneficial to, you know, take a step back when you're thinking, oh, we're playing narratively. How can I actually like use this for story purposes? Granted, you are going to need someone running the narrative.
Yes.
To keep that in line, like with what you're doing with LVO, where you want to say, hey, guys, no. We're going down to just, you know, core book, your book, and Thondia for Anvil of Apotheosis. Yep. And so it's very stripped down, you know, and let's just play on our merits more than it is anything else. And hopefully the narrative is driven that way. And of course, there are ways. And this is something that happens in like Necromunda, right? Where the person running it, Arbitrator Necromunda, is able to sort of craft things and balance things. You know, for that one person who's like, yeah, man, I'm doing flamethrower spam. I've got three hand flamers, two flamers, one heavy flamer, right? And then he's like, cool. So this next mission, you're playing in a place where there's a bunch of gas. And if you shoot your flamer, you explode.
Yeah.
Right? Because you can do that in Necromunda.
Yes, it's a beautiful
thing. We'll talk about that later. But those are the sort of like, you need to think creatively and expansively in order to see what you want to do and what you don't want to do. And you said, GW says, you don't have to use these rules. And that's something they do in 40K too. We'll talk a little bit more when we get into like the legend stuff. But, you know, it's definitely a whole bunch of, you don't need to at this moment, right? You can play with what you want to play.
That's right.
And build up from there. I mean, like, I know that, like, folks have been playing consistently, started with just core book, right? But as the other battle tomes and stuff have come out, the battle tomes are coming out in a time when a GHB is active,
yes. Right?
Take it back. Take your book that was released, you know, post-Thondia, post-second GHB, season one, right? And then go back to just core rules.
Yeah.
And play core rules and see what core rules have to offer you.
And if you're, you know, if you're doing a narrative thing, an event, keep in mind, you don't have to implement any of the General's Handbook stuff. Correct. You're doing a narrative and Those rules are based around competitive match play. Narrative doesn't, you don't, they're sometimes mutually exclusive. Mm-hmm. And don't feel like, well, this is the current structure that's involved in the scene right now, so we'll just continue that and we'll use that in our narrative. You don't have to. Don't use it.
Correct.
Be big enough to understand that maybe not everybody likes this. And the fact that this handbook invalidates a couple of factions it's abhorrent to me that mm-hmm. this was a design decision that was made at a time when you're trying to, I don't know, open the game up to many levels of players and many types. And you basically say, hey, mate, you can't play with your toys for the next 6 months. Sorry.
Yeah.
Go away. Now, you know, that's not to say, yes, you can play with any faction right now. None of them are. And again, it goes back to the fact that these are opinions, not criticisms. However, we all know that there's an in-truth tier list.
Yeah.
For every version of the meta. And right now there are some factions at the very bottom of that tier list. And I think in this general's handbook, the bottom of the tier list is seriously at the bottom. They are not fun or competitive. And I don't see a lot of workarounds for them. You know, with the monster meta, you could add a monster to anybody. You could always add monsters. You can't add Battleline to units or to factions that aren't real big on them. And it might force you to make list decisions that you don't want to make. All right. I want to play my Ogre Maw tribes. I do not want to be forced to have to go outside of my book to get units that I can then play with and be effective with and not spend a premium that no one else is having to pay for.
Talk about a faction that's got a little rough right now.
Ogres?
Yeah, like they just did not get a lot out of this new GHB. And I think that's sort of like an example.
Well, the thing is everyone else got their rules and they got nothing to separate themselves from this pack. And their reliance on their battle lines. Well, you know, if you literally want to do some of the groups in that book, just give it up. You're going to run into a wall of Judicators or a wall of Witch Elves that are just going to laugh at stomps and your things. And they're just going to wipe the floor with you.
Yeah, and it's frustrating when you have, I think that, you know, Ogres are just sort of like one of the big examples because they're actually pretty fun and popular. I mean, they're easy to collect, easy to build, easy to paint.
Eight models for an army, you know.
It's all super frustrating, though, you know, because folks aren't able to actually play with them currently because of the state of things, you know.
Well, and you even look at the newly released Sylvaneth, who are immediately on the back foot because of the way their battle lines are structured. And not saying that in any way they're not playable or they're not competitive. It's just that they are seriously not as, had this General's Handbook not come out, I think they would be in a much different place.
Agreed. And I mean, there could be simple fixes to that. I mean, I guess if you just made it so they count as additional models, right? Instead of, they count as three instead of one, you just say they count as two additional models. So then that way their rule kicks in plus some, right?
Right.
You know, but it comes out, it's a stark contrast. But if you, strip it all down to just base book plus battle tome, it's a good place to be.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I think the core rules are really good.
Mm-hmm.
I really enjoy them.
They really are. And going back to them was such a breath of fresh air. And it drove home the point that we don't have to play with these rules. We're not required. There's no police that come to your house that say you're not using the right handbook. Stop playing immediately. So anyway, beat to death AOS 40K. So if you think AOS is a little bit bloated with books and references that you need to bring with you to a game, now is not the time to get into 40K.
It's definitely not.
I saw a breakdown on Reddit the other day of some factions and the amount of books they are required to bring with them to play. Mm-hmm. And Some of them were in the 7-book range.
Jesus.
Yeah. So as well as some of them had like 3 books plus 2 White Dwarf issues. Others were like 2 or 3 books plus this printed out from the website, this PDF from the website, and this FAQ printed out. And it's like, we should not be in a system that's reasonably new.
Yeah.
We should not be in this place where we have to carry our library around with us. And if this is truly what you intend and how you want to make the game, give us the digital editions in machine readable formats,
correct,
not your crappy app. Okay. Your apps are not good.
Yeah. What's the thing? Oh, it's still in beta. I'm like,
okay.
Yeah. It's real bad though.
Yeah.
It's really bad.
It's a bad beta.
It doesn't work very well at all. And like, it's missing things. And then like the formatting's off. So you have like multiple lines running together. It's just garbage. But like 40K is rough right now. I mean, as we're talking about like shortly before the show, right? Like it feels like if you really wanted the game to be fun and balanced and stuff, and not just talking about like number of books you have to bring,
yeah,
you know, but like in just in terms of what your army's capable of doing, you know, you'd want to make sure that everyone's got a level playing field, right? The floor for everyone, right, is reasonably the same. Now, the ceiling we can disagree on in terms of like what you can do at the upper echelons of things, you know, but generally speaking, if like you look at a 1-story house and a 2-story house and someone says, which one's bigger in terms of height, I can tell you what it's going to be. I mean, the floor has been raised, right? If something's on a hill that something else isn't, right, you can tell the disparity, and that's a problem. And what they're doing is it's just like piecemealing it out.
Yes.
You know, because like, oh, we're just trying to get all these books out. I know COVID jacked up the release schedule.
Yes.
You know, but it's just like, boom, the next one comes out and you're like, well, here's the Spectre forever, right? Boom, another one comes out. Boom, another one comes out. You're like, dear God, how do we handle this?
Yeah.
You know?
And why do we? The big question is why? Again, it goes back to just because you can doesn't mean you should.
Exactly.
You know, the base 40K rule set is really good and really solid. It's all these attempts to improve it that are really making it convoluted.
Agreed.
And honestly, with the proliferation of special abilities and stratagems and what have you, we're getting back to where we were before, and that was not a good place.
Agreed.
There are so many combos out there in 40K that are not considered as they release these books and these, what do they call them? The updates, the data slates that are just not being effectively considered. And again, not knocking the design team. There's, what, 5 of them and maybe 10 some odd play testers that really help. They're not going to catch every combo. There's no physical way they can play enough games in an 8 to 10 hour day working straight for weeks to catch all this stuff.
Correct.
So, but also don't be afraid that when you see, you know, when the orc thing happened and there was that very outlying, very aberrant list that went through the Bay Area Open and basically tore everyone a new butt. that came up against it because he had unlocked a thing. He had went, oh, look, I can do this and this and this.
Yep.
And at the competitive level, that's what you want. Someone went out there, found something amazing, and took down a major tournament with it.
Oh, yeah.
And then the next week, I mean, literally tournament ended Sunday. Tuesday, the rules came out that said, you cannot do that. And I was just like, okay, they saw it. They were like, oh my God, how did we let that get by? Okay, no problem. Fix it. Don't be afraid to do that. Because if you let these things sit there and fester for too long, then when you finally do make the change and you are taking someone's toys away and all those people that went out and bought 10, 12, 15 buggies just to do that list, all of a sudden realized, well, I'm out all that money.
Yep.
Now you've got really salty players, and that's not something you want.
It definitely isn't. It's really tough to balance a game like this. I mean, there's so many elements to it, you know, but I guess what we can do just sort of as like players and in our own right. I mean, I know the competitive thing is the competitive thing.
Yeah.
Right? People are going to gravitate to the most powerful lists. They're going to use the most powerful players, you know, and go from there.
Yeah.
And that does ebb and flow and change. We talk about red deck wins all the time, you know?
Yeah.
People are going to see what's easiest to be done and they're going to do it. And then like, it's probably not going to be the thing that lasts the longest, but it's going to be the thing that has to be dealt with for a little bit of time, and then it'll be, you know, handled from there. So in terms of 40K, I mean, it's hard, but just try to have some fun with it. I mean, sometimes figuring out the combos is really fun, you know? I think that's going to be fun to play Crusade. I think it's going to be fun to play Alpha Legion, you know, because there's like some interesting combos in there that I just don't think people are trying, and I want to try them, you know, instead of like smooth brain type word bearers are the best because they just have the best thing.
Yeah.
Right. All right. Let's pull back for a second, you know, and rethink this, because if it isn't, it happens all the time. If it isn't immediately and readily the strongest thing, people are just not going to like it.
Yes.
And this happened the last time in 8th edition when they're dropping the subs and Iron Hands and Raven Guard came out. And I was like, man, Iron Hands is insane. And then I was reading the Raven Guard and I was like, oh, dear God.
No, wait a minute.
They're going to just start taking tournaments. And all you heard on the internet, Iron Hands. And I was like, no, someone's going to break Raven Guard. Raven Guard have too many sneaky abilities. They're just going to get in there. Sure enough, you know, I think it was like, a month in or something like that. They had the Assault Centurions, Combat Assault Centurions, just like, oh, I'm like right here. Oh, I charged you.
Yeah.
Right. I've got flamers. I just shredded your face. Like, that's just how it worked. It was really interesting. I hope for the best, you know, in terms of what they're doing to try and augment these things. It'd be great if we had everything out at once, because if we had every codex out and then they could be like, okay, let's figure this out, you know, which hopefully they would have done earlier. But
and, you know, also in their defense, this is not the greatest time in the world to be trying to balance games using data input from major tournaments. We're literally just now kicking off into the major tournament scene again, and it's coming, but the info's coming slowly. And I can understand they don't want to make crazy changes before they have really empirical data to support it.
Correct.
I do think, however, they can control the amount of rule bloat that is out there. And that is something that exists in design space, and you should do better. That's all I'm going to say on that. Moving on to 30K. 30K is so new. How could there be a problem?
the PDF. actually, one thing. Sorry.
Go back.
Rewind. All right. So on the 40K thing, the Legends fact that dropped, where they talked about all the Chaos Space Marine stuff that's not currently allowed in the book. And this is something where they use the same language they did in AOS, right? Which is, these are rules for every type of game. You can use them in every type of game. Our recommendation is to not allow them in match play competitive tournaments.
Yes.
Because, I mean, you think the Wombo combos right now with Chaos Space Marines are insane? Let's just go ahead and get, you know, a Jump Sork or a Jump Lord and just make it worse, you know? That said, I'm going to turn my Dominion Zephyn into a World Eater's Jump Lord.
Of course you are.
I mean,
you dog.
How could I not? I mean, / Praetor, / you know, it just has to be done. And I don't apologize for that. Good. It's going to be done.
Good.
That's just a little side note there, because I thought that was important because of how the language tracks, where GW is trying to say, hey, guys, you don't gotta.
And that's the thing, is they have always maintained this. Play the game you want to play. Drop the parts that you don't. This is why we're not ranting about where the games are, because you can fix it at your level any way you want.
Yeah.
There is nothing that says you have to play by this set right now, period. And there are some products that come out from GW that aren't as well thought out as others. Let's just face it.
Oh, yeah.
Not everything can get the absolute polish, again, segue into 30K, that the 30K rulebook got. It's a very good rule set. It's 7th edition. You know, I mean, they had years worth of data on this to draw from.
Oh, yeah.
This was not a hard one, although I'm not trying to minimize the amount of work that went into it, because I know, because of the interactions with reactions and everything else that came out, this was a tough rule set to put together and to make really good, and they did it. I think the basic rules for 30K are just, it's 7th edition with enough chrome and enough add-ons to be brilliant, and enough of the stupidity taken away to make it fun again.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I think this is what Ace should have been, but let's not go there. so at hot on the heels of that brilliant success, they released the Legacy PDF that was an unproduced, unfiltered mass of ickiness. I mean, I don't know what else to say. We kind of briefly mentioned it last time, but most places, most tournaments that I've heard of are saying no to the Legacy PDF. Just not no, but hell no.
So you don't have your like ridiculously powerful Dark Angel characters running around and sniping Primarchs?
And again, one of the beauties of the 30K rule set was they eliminated that without pissing off the existing player base. They took away the have and have not idea that if you have all the Forge World, you win all the games. And the guy that just bought the box is like, well, I can't compete. Screw this game. All right. They did a very good job of eliminating that. And then the Legacy PDF comes out and says, nope, here it is. Here it is. Here it is. If you spend money, you get to win. So the pay to win document is mostly being, and I have seen actually some, there are versions of the Legacy PDF that are being done by the homebrew community, the 30K existing community, that, you know, take each one of the characters and fix them. They take the vehicles and make them playable in this new version. So pay attention, GW. These guys are doing your work for you.
And that's just how passionate they are.
Yeah.
You know, and I feel like, you know, I put the note here. It's like, it's the opportunity to be like Necromunda if it can be, but on a larger scale because it's so popular.
Yep.
You know, I mean, one, people just want the models.
Yeah.
Right? Why did I buy a total of 3 Leviathan Dreadnoughts? Well, it wasn't just to have, you know, one for each of my 30K armies, right? Literally, I can use them in 40K.
That's right.
And so there's a lot of, you know, things that transfer back and forth. So it's great to have that flexibility. You have your TAC Marines. You have all this stuff. Boom, boom, boom. It's all there, right?
Yep.
But the thing I love about it is that, you know, depending on the version of Marine you pick, frankly, at this point.
Yeah.
Right. What your abilities are and how you manipulate those are what leads to victory, as opposed to, no, I've got like a weird, like 5-step combo that, you know, allows my Terminators to charge 6 inches, you know, when they come down from Deke's Dragon, like all that stuff, you know, there's so much more strategy into it, because it's not, you're pretty much on a level playing field, as we talked about, but there's also some fun, unpredictable stuff, you know?
And the Legions should have their own flavors, and they do, without being over the top. And yes, Dark Angels right now are the bugaboo. Sure, they're very strong. They're not unkillable, and they don't win every game.
Yep.
Even the guys at the bottom, the Salamanders, are winning games. So it's not like, oh, they're so... The difference between the top and the bottom are... a lot of times it comes down to player skill, period. So, and that's a good place. Let's not leave it. And let's get rid of that PDF, please. Just get rid of it. I mean, some of it is so absolutely, it was like two different teams worked on that. It had to have been two different groups working on it, because one was so effectively and well written. The other one is just a travesty of justice. Going to move on to now some highlights and good things.
Yeah.
Like some of the other games, some of the support, the feeder games, the box games.
Yep.
Why Kill Team and Warcry are working and why they have rabid communities is because the rule set is tight.
Yep.
It works, and they haven't bloated it. They haven't added so much stupidity to it that it has become watered down and bogged down in what the main big games are bogged down into.
Yep.
And I think it's the approach of Kill Team and Warcry. They are very competitively narrative games.
Oh, yeah.
And they do not make that big distinction of, yes, there are sections of the rule book that are for narrative play. And there is a section for competitive play. But the line between them is so blurry that you can't play Kill Team without having a slight nod to the narrative.
Yeah.
And nor can you play narrative Kill Team without any of the competitive thought process behind it. Mm-hmm. It blurs the line in this beautiful amalgamation of the rules are the same for everyone, and I don't have to be afraid of you, other than Harlequins. Right. But they're fixing it. I mean, it's by and large, both of the games, Warcry and Kill Team, are very, very well balanced, and you're going to be playing those in an environment other than, you know, at competitive tournaments. And again, this doesn't apply to the competitive scene, which is its own thing.
Yeah.
You know, but when you get into the pods at LVO, Adepticon, Nova, and all that stuff, you are playing a different game. You are playing just to win, period. Yeah. And if you're not and you're in a competitive tournament, it's your fault for asking to be narrative. Really, I mean, it is. If you enter a competitive AOS tournament, Adepticon, or, you know, even a local tournament that is labeled competitive, don't ask them to be all narrative and squishy and bring fun lists. No, they're there to beat face and understand that. And don't go there thinking, well, this was a bad scene because everybody was just so hyper focused on winning. Well, yeah, it was a competitive event. So,
yes, sir.
Kill Team and the Warcry, they just weave through the competitive and narrative paths so seamlessly and so easily that you kind of forget that there's even a delineation between the two. It's just baked in.
It really is. I think that's pretty fun. I mean, there's of course ways to min-max and all those things which the competitive players are doing, but this is a fun time to, like, I'm just going to focus down and model, like, one unit is essentially what it translates to in 40K. And so you get these really beautiful, like, custom jobs on all these different characters. I absolutely love it. Oh, you know, man. It's so great to see the amount of effort people are putting into it. And it, like, it's not just good rules.
Yeah.
It's also more creative space for some people who are just like, God, I can't paint, you know, 2000 points.
Yeah.
Well, you have to paint 10 models and you can build them how you want and all that stuff.
And just go crazy.
It's so cool.
Let's segue that into Necromunda. Take that away.
See, I think Necromunda it's my favorite system that they've got, hands down. Cause you know, the things that we like about Warcry, the things we like about Kill Team, those are there, you know?
Yep.
And certainly, obviously, it's more 40K oriented in a way, just because, you know, Mordheim isn't out.
don't say that word.
I'm just saying, it'd be a really cool, fun adaptation of Necromunda. Anyway, so Necromunda, there's so much fun to it, and it also, like, sparks the RPG player, right, that some people have, because that's one of I'll say, there's a fair amount of people who play these war games who also play like tabletop RPGs, or they might even play RPGs generally on PS5, PS4, and those kinds of games lend themselves to, well, how's my character going to develop? What kind of skills are they going to get? You know, that kind of thing. And this game has it, you know, and there are ways to, like, and most people coming in Necromunda understand there's going to be the arbitrator who's there to, like, limit certain circumstances. Right. So, all right. So we're going on this mission. All right. Here's the twist. It's full of a corrosive gas. If you spark any flame, this is what happens. And so then...
But I bought my list of flavors.
Right? Well, you're just going to detonate the entire area. Like, so that just makes it interesting for those people who are trying to, like, metagame and min-max and all that. Because that did happen in the last time running the Necromunda campaign. I talked about it before. But,
yeah,
you know, some dude, like, spamming hand flamers, heavy flamers, all those things. And... So I went to play him, and I was like, cool, I got the first turn. I rocket launched all of his guys. You know, that sucks, man. You know, he ended up retreating, so that way he didn't have to take any more losses. But it has, like, that capability to balance it out. And there's randomness to it in a fun way. In terms of the game itself, right? You know, I lob a grenade. It doesn't just go away if you miss.
Right.
It goes somewhere.
It's going to go, yeah.
Yeah. We gotta understand that. I'm shooting a flamethrower. Well, everything... in that direction from where the flame is produced is going to get burned. Oh, but my guys are there.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. They're hot.
Yeah. Hot. You know, the aftermath sequencing and stuff like that, which we see a lot of that coming in Path to Glory, right, coming in Crusade, the aftermath sequencing has an effect.
Yeah.
And it's fun. It makes sense that, well, sometimes when your gang's just starting out, you know, and if you're in a bad one, you're just scraping money together so that way Jimmy doesn't die,
yeah.
you know? But, you know, it's like, you know, the gang proceeds, you know, either you make it or you're broken. And I love it, right? There's so much dynamism to it, and it, the random qualities of it create such a strong narrative.
Yeah.
That you're just going to have a good time. It's rare that someone just gets blown out. But then you have the arbitrator coming. Here's how I'm going to help you out.
Yeah.
You know, like, oh, my Gene Seeler cult, for some reason, they're just getting obliterated. It's like, all right, cool. Well, you know, the cult sends you reinforcements. There you go. You know, just some basic dudes.
We can do all kinds of, I think Necromunda as the new rule set is potentially one of the few that GW has come out with where they kept all the flavor of the original and just simply updated the mechanics to be a lot better.
Yeah.
Kill Team doesn't have a precursor. Warcry did not have precursors. AOS, literally, if you want to admit it, it does not have a precursor. Fantasy was not the basis for Age of Sigmar. AOS was brand new.
Yep.
40K has evolved over the years. And what's really interesting to see now is this divergent path where the 8th, 9th, 10th, coming edition are going down this different route as opposed to 30K, which has gone back to the roots of 40K, the 2nd through 7th edition rule set without the bad parts, with a lot of the good parts and a lot of modern design methodology. So they're really flexing a lot of design space, and we're not here to sit there and criticize and poke and say what's wrong with this and that and the other thing. It's an understanding that these things are evolving as we go. We just would like to see the evolution have a little more thought as to how it's going to affect not just the competitive community, but those people that can't or don't know how to separate narrative from competitive.
Yeah. I'm not going to say it's a perfect game, but it's pretty darn close for me in terms of what I want out of this kind of a game.
Yep.
You know, we have the vehicles coming in. It's super promising.
Yes.
Right? Everything is super promising right now. I mean, nothing has really come out of Necromunda that just, like, breaks the game or makes it horrible or anything like that. I just want to see what everyone's going to get in terms of what vehicles, you know, or, like, what the vehicle creation rules are.
Yeah.
So that way we can really understand what's the breadth of this, you know? There are things, obviously, that a lot of people have access to, you know, with the transports now.
Yeah.
The Goliath have been previewed some pretty cool bikes coming out. Trikes, I guess you call them.
God, they're so cool.
Right? I saw that and I was like, that is hella Necromunda. You know, I'm excited to see what all of the different gangs are going to have access to, right? Like, I can't even imagine what the Vansar are going to have. It's probably going to be some pretty slick, like, hover speeder bike stuff. I'm stoked for that.
Oh my, it's gonna be nuts.
It's gonna be so cool. It's such a fun system, and you know, I pretty much sell it on this podcast every chance I get.
But yeah, you do. It's good.
But it's great. It's one of those games. It doesn't take long as long as you're like efficient with it. You know what you're doing, right? Maybe an hour.
Yeah.
Because you don't have to play big games, and like if you got a good like flow going with the arbitrator and stuff, it's gonna have like a meaningful place in the storyline and the terrain part of it.
Oh my god.
Necromunda is a terrain builder's dream.
It really, and the stuff that they've put out is so bonkers good. And then Necromunda hits so many different other manufacturers of terrain that if you don't like the GW motif, there's Death Ray design, you name it. There's I can't even begin to start. There's Battle Kiwi, all these places. Someone's going to have an aesthetic that you like. And if you have a 3D printer, the world is your oyster. I mean, you can literally do anything. It's just such a great, it's so open. It's so vibrant. And I'd hate to see it lose any of that going forward. But honestly, I don't see anything in the vehicle expansion that really just breaks it.
Exactly.
And it's designed to be a separate sort of environment.
Yes,
so,
yes.
You know, don't worry about it destroying the base game, because it won't.
Yeah.
And you can agree to use it or not.
And I have to say, like, you know, we talk about how, like, the orc stuff looked Mad Max-y and everything.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, if you really, really wanted to have, like, a Mad Max-style game, Necromunda Ashen Waste has just done that for you.
It's right there, and you don't have to do all the work. They've done 90% of it for you. It's gorgeous.
I'm pretty stoked, and I don't see Necromunda getting messed up at all, but it is really strong.
So overall, as far as just because we can, should we? To wrap up, I just want to use sort of a kind of a catch-all phrase that I put in the thing here, and it's GW, this game's been around. These games have been around for a long, long time, and it's just kind of like paint pots, okay? The entire world has gone to dropper bottles. You maintain paint pots, and your logic behind them is the most threadbare and ridiculous logic I have ever heard in my life. Well, we have to consider every environment that people are painting in. And I'm like, yeah, okay, that makes zero sense. So embrace change. You look at some of these other games that are out there, and I'm not saying you take the concepts or the mechanics from these games, but you look at the concepts. So many games these days are getting away from the I go, you go. And even though you're adding reactions to almost every game system you have to make it a little bit more interactive throughout the turn, why don't you do a we go kind of a thing? Why don't we have something like Star Wars Legion where you draw chits to see who goes next?
Yeah.
Maybe that's not perfect. Maybe it doesn't really fit for you. Maybe it's just simply a, hey, at the top of the turn, whoever has initiative picks two units to act with, and they move, shoot, charge, and assault, you know, and close combat. And then I pick a unit, and then we alternate. Or, you know, I'm not telling you how to do it because I'm not a game designer. I am here to tell you that your games like Kill Team and Warcry, where you alternate activations, are very, very popular.
Yeah.
And I understand that this is a complete rewrite. Everything will have to be rewritten because you cannot take these rules and turn it into a WeGo system.
Yeah.
As written. And that's okay. I'll let you do that. You can take 10th. You can make 10th edition. You know, take some time, work it out. I'll let it go. it's pretty big of me, I know, but
you're a giver.
I am. That's my problem. I give too much. Sorry, I was trying to quote the old line there. But there are other mechanics that are out there. And, you know, as much as we all love the D6, and you've made a $1 billion on very different kinds of D6s,
yep.
Maybe we look for a little bit more granularity in our combat systems. Maybe a D8 would add, you know, some more flavor to the game. Maybe a D10. D10s are really cheap, and you can put, you know, I'm throwing you a bone here, guys.
Exactly.
There's things to think about that could make the game better and bring it into the 2020s. And I still kind of feel like we are mired in that 1999 rogue trader mentality of,
fair enough,
this is a D6 and a plus one is really cool. Yeah. Well, nowadays we're looking at AP minus six, and it invalidates the D6 completely. And so you're having to make these rolls that are like, okay, so you're a 2+ re-rolling ones. Why don't you just say it auto hits? Okay. Why don't the amount of variability in hitting on a 2 re-rolling ones is ridiculously stupid. Yes, there's going to be times where you roll 2 ones in a row. It happens to me all the time, but honestly,
yeah,
just say auto hit.
Yeah.
Or, you know, go to a D10. You have so much, you the granularity you can have now is basically, because of the way the math works, it's almost doubled. So, and it gives you so much more space to design fun things without having to add a rule that says Harlequins are just better than everyone else. Shut up. Those are our thoughts for fixing the systems. Do you have any way to overarchingly fix the design space?
Yeah, actually, Bill, I didn't tell you this earlier, but I figured out how to fix it all.
Oh, my God.
I didn't.
We're all moving to infinity?
It's quite simple, actually. Just let the world burn.
Yeah. Okay.
And then when all of humanity is gone, all the problems will melt away as well.
Okay, I've been playing too much Outriders and other games for you to say stuff like that. That hurts. Okay.
So, I mean, it's real tough. And we just have to be raise a community to, well, if you want to play the game, play the damn game. Like,
and play it your way.
Exactly. Like, oh, I mean, does every single thing need to be 100% competitive? Yeah, I mean, that's what you get on the internet, right? That's what a lot of people talk about, is how you be competitive in this game. What if you didn't want to be?
Yeah.
Like, I know you're watching, you know, like, great players, Seasons of War. You're watching, you know, Warhammer Weekly. You're watching all these people who know what the hell they're talking about because they're so well-versed on in it, you know? Are you actually going to play competitively? Because if not, I mean, definitely take what knowledge you can get from that. Sure. But just go throw down a friendly open play game.
Yep.
You know? Decide, you know what? We are going core book. Or, yeah, I don't want to deal with this weird battle line stuff in the new one. Let's just do Thondia, you know? Yeah. There are ways to do it. And have fun with it.
That's right. You know,
it's your game.
Make it your game. Play it your way. And when the rest of the crowd doesn't want to go with you, leave them behind.
Every day.
Forge ahead. Move forward. Sorry. Had a little Devo moment there. All right. So wrapping up lore. Did you have any closing thoughts?
I mean, I think we've been sort of beating this point to death, but make it your game. Like, it's really hard sometimes to get caught up in just all the rules and the bloat and everything and just lose sight of what it was you're doing in the first place, which is having some damn fun.
Yeah. These are games. And by the very nature, a game should be fun. It's a chance for you to get together with another person and spend an hour to 3 hours telling a story that you want to tell and having some fun. Unless, of course, you're one of those competitive-only folks, in which case it's an hour to 3 hours of trying to beat someone's face into the ground. Hopefully that person has the same attitude as you. otherwise, one of you is going away unhappy.
Yeah, that does happen sometimes.
Yeah.
So take it for what it is. You know, like if you're going that competitive route, I mean, God bless it. You're not going to be able to, you know, be dissuaded from, you know, that course, which is... Oh. Whatever it is, I got to do the best with what I got from the match play stuff. And hopefully things change up. And maybe, you know, definitely not, you know, GW official tournaments, but the other tournament organizers can really get together and say, okay, here's what we want, mm-hmm. right? So let's strip out these rules and play what we want to play. But also, like you said, Bill, just go back to core,
yeah.
you know? And if you're just like frustrated and you can't have it anymore, go back to core.
I was amazed at how really well it worked mm-hmm. with all of the new rules because he was playing Daughters of Cain with the new book. And I was playing, what's the name, Nighthaunt with the new book. And the interactions were simple and easy. And I never at any point felt like, well, I don't have a chance.
Yeah.
That unit just, I can't play. No, mm-mm. It was there. It was on the table. And it felt good. And that first game where we were using the battle line thing, that was not fun. And it wasn't fun for either of us because the sum total of his movement and his interaction with that game was moving to occupy objectives
mm-hmm.
with witch elves and then using the snake ladies to go out and just do stuff. And mm-hmm. to be honest, boring.
Yeah.
Just boring. And... Yay. You know, it was one of those, like, he was like, yay, I win. I didn't see that coming.
Mm-hmm.
Really? You didn't? Yeah, no, I knew. I knew yeah. when we set up, it was over.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, yeah, that's what I thought. So you make it your game. Never, ever feel like GW is not telling you, you must do this. Never lose sight of the fact that they themselves put it out there. Use what you want. Play the game you want. They have never said, other than competitive events, they have never come out and said what you have to do.
And if you have doubt about all that and you're just not sure what to do, just play Necromunda and you'll be okay.
Yeah, exactly. Just, you know. Okay. So, hey, next time we get together, we're going to bring back something from the dead where we go over the White Dwarf from... 10 years ago and 20 years ago.
Oh, boy.
Okay. We're not doing it. I have them out this time. We're not going to do it because we didn't really get a chance to look at them before the show. So it would be really exciting radio where we flip pages and go, oh, that's cool. So we'll be a little bit more prepared next time, but stay tuned for our White Dwarf retrospective, because believe me, they are. It's funny when you see how far we've come and how we haven't moved an inch.
Yeah.
You know, it's really weird, but stay tuned for After Dark.
Yeah. Thanks for sticking with us, folks. And we got a little bit more to talk about, you know, Bill and I, about GW. When I said slash and rant earlier.
Yeah.
I was lying.
That's right.
So, well, for those of you sticking around, we'll see you after dark.
If you would like to get in touch with us, you can reach us at our Facebook page at www.facebook.com/rollingbadpodcast, all one word. Our Patreon page is at www.patreon.com/rollingbadpodcast, again, all one word. The Twitter account for the show is at @rolling_bad. Our individual Twitters are, for me, at Bill Castello, BillCastello. And for Josh, you can reach him at Anoyo, Anoyoe. All the guests on the show will have their contact information in that show's show notes. The music in the show is used courtesy of Kevin MacLeod at Incompetech.com and is used under the Creative Commons license. The Rolling Bad podcast itself is protected under the Creative Commons Attribution 4.0 International License. Information for this license can be found at creativecommons.org.